The formation of a planet and a planetary system is a multi-staged process, and it's a very complicated process also because basically we have to explain the growth over about 13 orders of magnitude in size, which means that we have to go from tiny grains of dust to something as big as a giant planet. And so we try to simplify this by thinking that this happens via a number of stages. And at the first stage is basically that we start from one of these huge clouds in the interstellar space in a star-forming region where such a cloud can, when it's dense enough, such a cloud which is made mostly of hydrogen, helium and some tiny dust can collapse under its own gravity when it's cold and dense. And while collapsing, it also starts to turn because angular momentum, so this is a quantity which describes how strongly something is turning, is conserved. And this means that the gas cannot collapse in one point, which is then the star, but it falls onto a part around this star, which is the protoplanetary disk. And in this disk, we start thus with gas, mostly hydrogen and helium, about 95% or 99%, and a little bit of tiny dust grains. And from this, we then need to form the planets. So this is basically the first stage. And then what happens next? So now we have these tiny micrometer-sized grains, and what they now do is start to collide with each other. At the beginning, very gently, meaning that they can stick together via intermolecular forces, so via electrostatic forces, meaning that over time, from these very tiny grains, they become larger and larger. This forms fractal structures. And we also have to take into account that there is a difference what happens in the inner part of the planetary system, so closer to the star compared to further away. Because there is a temperature gradient in this disk around the just born star, this very young star, in the sense that closer in, it's of course warmer, and further out, it's colder. And this has an important consequence on the composition of these dust grains, in the sense that in the inside, they are made of rocky material, so silicates and iron, and outside it's cold enough so that water can condense also. So there they also contain volatiles, and there is a jump, there is a line where there is this change between rocky and icy composition, and this is called the ice line. And traditionally it is thought that this explains why in the inside we have terrestrial planets and the outside we have giant planets.
If you think about planet formation, the water is a key element in this whole process. In the outer solar system, where the temperature is cool enough so that water ice can exist, the water ice acts like a glue for the planet formation process. The building blocks can easily stick together and building up larger planets than in the inner planetary system. And the perfect analogy for this is building a sandcastle on the beach. The sand is silicates, exactly the same material what builds up the planets, that's also silicates in this planet-forming disk. And imagine that you want to build a sandcastle. If you have dry sand, you're not really going to succeed. You can try to use larger pressure and then maybe you can build something, but it's not going to be a sandcastle. But if you put water into the sand, then that's going to help you to build the sandcastle because that's going to make the particles stick together. This is the exact same process for planet formation as well. The dust is eventually sticking together and building up larger and larger objects, and which we first call planetesimals, and then when they reach roughly 1,000 kilometers in size, then we call them protoplanets, and it's going to be the seeds for further planet formation.
Now what happens is that, especially outside of the ice line, these protoplanets probably can grow more massive because there is more matter available, because additionally we have these ices, so some of these protoplanets, they grow massive enough such that during the lifetime of this gas disk, they reach a mass of about 10 Earth masses. And when this happens, then their gravitational pull becomes strong enough so that they can really strongly attract the gas from the surrounding disk, and then they can grow to become a giant planet, because giant planets are mostly made of hydrogen helium gas that they accreted from this protoplanetary disk, and then we get an object like Jupiter and Saturn.
So this whole core formation and then a gas accretion is the so-called core accretion formation scenario. However, gas giant planets might form in a different way. There is another theory, a bit less popular, that's the disk instability formation scenario. In this case, gas giants are forming similarly like stars, because it says that if this original disk around the star is really massive, then it's going to have some clumps in it, similarly as stars are forming, and these clumps going to collapse under their own self-gravity directly into a giant planet. And then these giant planets are usually much more massive than what core accretion scenario can be at, say, 5 times the Jupiter mass or more massive. And also in these cases, the giant planets usually do not have solid cores, since they are just gas balls which are collapsing under their own self-gravity. In the case of giant planets, as this giant planet is still forming and growing and accumulate more and more gases, this envelope is also going to cool. And as it cools, again, the outer envelope might collapse into a disk, similarly as the disk around the star formed. And in this case, this is going to be around the planet. And within that disk, again, the planet formation process going to start, but in this case, we're going to form moons, right? Because we are talking about solid objects that are orbiting planets, and those we call moons. However, the building of those moons are very much the same procedure as we build terrestrial planets. The reason that that we form these disks around the giant planets is because they have large enough mass, they have large enough gravity, and this is the reason why we see the moon systems in the outer solar system where we have the giant planets, because only there this disk formation around the planets can happen. The reason why we have moon around Earth is a very lucky case, because Earth always was so small in mass that it could never form a disk around itself. So actually how our own moon formed was because there was a planet-planet collision. The very early stage Earth was hit by a Mars-sized planet, which we call Theia, and from this collision, the ejecta eventually formed the moon around Earth. But this planet-planet collision doesn't happen so often, and so most of the terrestrial planets, actually like Venus and Mercury, don't have moons for this reason, because they could never form a disk, and they also did not experience planet-planet collision, or at least that planet-planet collision never formed a moon. So we are a very lucky case in that sense, that how our own moon formed around Earth, but this is not the most usual moon formation scenario.
Then finally, over very long time scales, we have now giant planets in the system, but we have the terrestrial planets in the system. Then over billions of years, the dynamical interaction go on, so they can rearrange their orbits. Some in our system, now it's stable, more or less. Maybe not forever, but at least on long time scales of billions of years. So some objects can be ejected, there can still be some collisions, and some objects, some protoplanets even fall into the stars. And once the system is then stable over a long time, this is then the architecture of this planetary system that we can observe nowadays.